I'm Mani Abrol. I head a R&D center for a startup called Lexity here in Bangalore. I've had in my past experience, I'm not a researcher at all, but in my experience, I've had the opportunity to work in various roles which have been a go between research and product. I was in an enterprise search company called Verity, and where I worked on some newer products, worked with scientists to take some ideas to the end user. And then I was part of Yahoo Research for several years, where I worked with Sujana and worked in a similar role. Now I'm in a pure R&D in a product-driven role. And so I kind of have some understanding of what it would take. That's about me, and I'm just going to hand over for the panelists to introduce themselves and get started.
Hi, good afternoon. I'm Aarti Dev. I'm a senior manager at Amazon in our machine learning team there. I have a PhD in electrical and computer engineering, so that was my experience on the research side. But since then, I've largely worked in industry. I've had the good fortune of contributing to developing a lot of new products. So as part of that, there have been research techniques used within those. But like Mani said, I don't think I'm a researcher either. I'm really a product development person at heart, but really get excited about building new products and new systems. Prior to Amazon, I worked at FICO, where we build predictive software systems. And like I said, currently I work on developing various machine learning applications.
Hi, I'm Surabhi. I work at Google. I'm a software engineer there. I've been there for about five and a half years. And so I've done a variety of things there. Spent a bunch of years working on improving the ranking of results. And so that was a very research role. And then it was for a product, but a lot of it is just back-end work. So you're sort of doing all the research, you just don't publish the work. And then before that, in school actually, I did a lot of research. I did internships in research labs, like Microsoft Research. And I always had this thing in the back of my mind, like, do I want to go and do a PhD, or do I want to sort of continue on this path? And what I realized is that I really like working on something that ends in a product, and that there are a lot of roles where you get to do research as part of figuring out what that product should be. And that's what brought me to what I do right now. And more recently, actually, the last 2 years, I've been working on a very experimental project where we tried many different things, and finally we're sort of getting to a stage where we are launching things, but it's been a lot of uncertainty along the way.
Hi everybody, I'm Srujana. I'm a researcher with a machine learning background. Actually, as of this week, I'm unemployed. Till last week, I was with IBM. And the next week, I'm moving to Amazon. The same group as Aarti's. And prior to being at IBM, I was with Yahoo Research in Sunnyvale. And a little bit about my background. So I did a PhD in University of Texas at Austin. That was way back. And unlike the other folks who've actually had experience being in, interacting with the product teams, my experience has been mostly in research teams. So I've only worked in so-called research teams. And even the internships that I did were all with the research labs. So one thing I wanted to add here is that though I was in these designated research roles, it kind of removes you from the nitty-gritty of the product development, and there's a lot of freedom to explore new ideas. But at the end of the day, there is an expectation that the research finally contributes to the bottom line of the company in some meaningful way. And so it's really important to figure out how to pick the problems that really matter, and also figure out the process of pushing these research ideas into real concrete functioning products. So, that's why I'm like really interested in this topic, and I would like to even thank Rashmi, who invited me for this panel discussion.
So did you want us to say some fun stuff about us?
Yes, please. Can you share something more about your professional role?
About my professional role, I'm a research scientist.
Besides that, can you
talk? Besides my professional role, okay. as of now, I don't have much time for other things other than my kid. And you know, I keep telling him silly stories. That's the most fun stuff I do now. Back when I was younger, I used to do crazy things. You know, I ran a small shop. You know, built a water fountain from scratch. Campaigned for political, you know, events, things like that, elections and so on. But yeah.
So I guess activities outside of work, more professionally I'm involved in a lot of you know, mentoring related events, and I actually just attended Grace Hopper in Baltimore a couple of months back, so a lot of things related to that. And then another thing is I'm getting married soon, so a lot of my events that I've been doing are related to that, so I started doing calligraphy. It was my goal to, like, I wanted to write the invitations. And so I had this goal from like a year back, and I joined all these calligraphy classes, and it, I mean, it takes up a lot of time and it's hard, but I don't know, I feel like if I have a 1 year goal of achieving something, then I'm better at like, okay, yeah, and this is my end goal, as opposed to, oh, in my free time I'll do this, because we're all really busy and it's hard to sort of just find that free time. And so everything I did is kind of with some goal in mind.
Okay, so as far as extracurricular activities, I learn music. I've been a jack of all trades and master of none as far as hobbies goes, I think, because I've learned Hindustani music, Carnatic music, I've learned dance for a few years. I'm learning badminton again. I used to play badminton before, and I've started taking coaching again. So, and I like trekking a lot. Last year we trekked to Mount Kailash, which was kind of an exciting trip. So that's as far as extracurricular activities. Do you want me to talk about the role a little bit? So currently at Amazon, we have set up a relatively new machine learning team where we are really focused on leveraging machine learning for different applications and systems at Amazon. And this is a little bit of a different team within the Amazon context, because typically in Amazon, teams are very business focused. In this case, we are really a horizontal team, and our charter is to help other teams incorporate machine learning into their systems and processes as quickly and as efficiently as possible. And so as part of that, we are building platform services and application services as well. I manage the team that's working with different business teams on specific applications. And so just as an example, to make it a little more tangible, one of the systems we are building is a predictive health system, where we are trying to predict the question that our customer would ask us when they try to contact us, and provide them a very specific answer based on their profile, so that then they don't have to email us or call us. And it's a very interesting project, because, you know, in some sense we were saying we are building like psychic associates, because we are, you know, the person is going to kind of get a start if we are able to accurately guess what he or she is going to ask us. But that's what we're trying to do. And the goal is really to help them get answers very quickly. So that's an example of one of the applications we're building.
Thanks, guys. So I think I'm going to start with you, Surabhi, and ask you, so you're not in a traditional research org, and your passion is to research, and you've got opportunities to do that. So can you tell me about your more about your role, and how did you get those opportunities?
Okay, so when I was finishing up my master's, I was at Stanford, and it was very popular over there to just go to startups and sort of like the next thing to do. And so at that point, my choices were, I knew I wanted to work. My area was natural language processing and machine learning, and so I knew I wanted to stay in that area. And so I was considering other search companies. There was Cosmix, which was, you know, more of a startup, and then there was Google. And I kind of knew that I would work on the ranking, and so that was an area that really interested me, and so I said, okay, let me just try this out, and I'll get to work with really fun people and smart people. And so that's what got me into my role at Google. And then I was working on that. The one thing that I found about that role was that it was a lot of sort of work that I did. I was working independently, you know, you push out, just as, you know, I guess as a grad student, you sort of do work, and then if it works, if your results are positive, then you can kind of get launch approval, and then you launch. So that's kind of like rinse, repeat. It's kind of that schedule, that cycle. And then a few years in, I was just talking to someone, and he told me that, you know, he's starting up a new team to do something very experimental, like sort of think of how to change the way people search. And it was a very ambitious goal. It was something that, you know, for something at Google where search is as established as it is, I thought it was like sort of a really, really good opportunity to really think outside the box and see if you were to redo this, right? Like we're very used to, you know, you have the search box and you type a few words and then you expect to get results that always just really answer exactly what your question is. And so I thought, okay, like if you were to redefine this, and let's say, you know, you think of the bigger picture and you guide a user more instead of the user directing their questions towards Google, how would you do that? And so we started off with this goal, and that's what brought me to that role. And that project kind of just fell into place, and it's been a really fun ride because, you know, we started off with that goal, but of course we did like many different iterations, and most of them, you know, honestly don't work. I think we had really good products all along the way, but when you do it at a big company, you have to get buy-in. Like you can build something great, but if other people are not convinced of it, it's not going to work. And so it was sort of constant research and product development. So it was just one team that we did all of that.
Cool. It can't get more cutting edge than that, right? So we've got two panelists who are working in product organization and contributing to innovative products, newer experimental products, and we have Srujana here who is actually been most of the time in a pure research role, but also impacted product. What I wanted to ask Srujana was, how do you define research and innovation, and how do you differentiate between the two?
Thanks, Mani. So one thing I think about research, I guess this is influenced by my background as, you know, somebody who's been in a traditional research organization. So the way I think of research is something, you know, activity that adds to our collective body of knowledge. And, you know, I don't really think so much in terms of the company needs. Of course, that matters at the end of day, but really, you know, there's a lot of research that doesn't necessarily go into a product. For instance, there could be negative results, right? That, you know, you have this problem for which some method will not work or will not work well. And that's not going to translate directly into a product, but it is going to at some point influence design decisions that somebody else is going to make, right? And it could be someone, I mean, companies tend to, you know, want to keep this information to themselves, but, you know, there is an aspect of research that somehow, you know, is like this collective good, where we want to create this new knowledge that everybody can share and, you know, everybody makes use of at some point. And there are also other types of research, right? Like, for instance, you know, results that are just trying to understand, get a deeper understanding of what works and what does not work. So these are things that don't necessarily translate to product. But now let me just come to the things that do translate to product, right? So even there, I find that, you know, there is a little bit of difference between what you would call innovate and research. A lot of times, you know, it takes a long while. It's simpler to, you know, this is something I had just a brief discussion with Mani about. You can do fairly simple things and get to 90% of the performance or 90% of what you desire. But the last part, you know, doing the last 10% is really tough, and those are like, you know, the really hard fruits to grab. So once you're done with the low hanging fruits, it takes a lot of effort to get there. And these are, there's definitely, you know, sometimes you could call it incremental research, but it is also tough, and you know, it sometimes doesn't change the way things are done, but it, you know, just moves the needle a little bit. And then there are these other kinds of activity, which I would say as innovation, right? Sometimes you don't need to do a lot of, you know, new research to change the way things are done. A simple idea, like say the way Twitter works, right? They just limited the character limit, and, you know, they changed the way messages are visible to people. So it really didn't need a lot of new research, but it kind of, you know, identified some unmet customer need and, you know, really attacked that problem. And I would call that also as an innovation. So I really think of these two as, you know, is overlapping,
you know, areas of activity, and there's a big overlap, of course, because lots of research leads to innovation, but there is research that sometimes just moves the needle a little bit. It's tough research, but it moves the needle a little bit, doesn't necessarily change the way you do things, but gives you a deeper understanding. And then there is, you know, other types of innovation that doesn't necessarily, you know, need new research, but it just needs maybe, you know, some light bulb going off in somebody's head that, oh, we could have done this. So
great, yeah. Great. So I want to hear about some examples of what you guys may have initiated as a research project and which may have been successful or may have been a failure. So just give some examples on your contribution and how you kind of try to move the needle. You understand that?
Okay, so I can talk about a product we developed at my previous organization. This was to detect healthcare fraud. And we really wanted to build statistical models or neural network models to detect fraud. And there were no, see, typically when you build models, you have historical data that tells you which are sort of the fraudulent cases and which are not. And then you can build models to learn those patterns. In this case, there was no historical data on fraudulent doctors. And so we had to use some really new types of techniques to find fraud. And this was really an unproven sort of technology. We brainstormed it ourselves and came up with a way to sort of create a suspect list of fraudulent doctors. And it was very new. And we really were not sure how it was going to work. And there were a lot of details to be worked out in terms of the data, in terms of the patterns of medical practice that are seen in that particular region, things like that. But we were able to make it work. So initially when we built the models and got the results, we knew the results were good, but there was a lot of work to take those results out to the customer and really make them understand those. And that's where like some of the innovation things come in, because then we built a lot of reports and other creative sort of visual things around those results to make the customer understand the results better and get better context for those. So that's one example where, you know, we didn't really use any accepted technique, but sort of brainstormed a new, really a new research technique ourselves, but we're able to then bring value to the customer through that.
Okay. I want to hear an idea where actually didn't work. I want to hear about an idea that didn't work, that did not work, and you know, you couldn't actually.
That did not work. Okay. So, you know, I've been doing this for a while. So when I was fairly young, I, you know, had a very academic bent of mind. I mean, for most people in product teams, I might still come across as somebody with the same kind of, you know, views. But back then, it was far worse. So for me, and I went into this organization, which was a pure research lab. So there, the charter for the group was to do the state of art science in particular areas. Like this was Yahoo research, so they were focusing on machine learning, optimization, you know, microeconomics, areas of that type. And what they wanted to do was really build a group that was like a hiring magnet for people, help with the recruiting, help with branding, and also influence the product teams. But what, you know, around the time I joined, it was, the group started around, I think, late 2005 and joined in 2006. So there was a big disconnect between the product teams and this pure research team. So we had not yet established these channels. So an example of the thing that we did and did not work out very well is this idea. Basically, the idea was that, you know, there's a lot of user-generated content out there. And for instance, in Yahoo Local, there was an interface for people to, you know, correct in addresses, phone numbers, you know, information about various businesses, restaurants. There was an interface to collect that data, but that data was never used to really go and enrich the database. So there was, in fact, this was something nice that somebody thought about and did. So we had all this nice data. And our idea was to take this very unreliable, noisy data and try to, you know, clean it up, denoise it, and really make a very up-to-date database. So, you know, we were fairly young. We thought, of course, there is a strong business use case.
And then we thought, fine, let's go work on this problem. And so we went back, we did a very thorough design of, you know, how to go about data representation for uncertain data with multiple users, multiple sources. So this is like lots of theoretical data representation work. Then we worked on algorithms. And since the charter of the group was to primarily have this external academic impact, we went ahead, you know, and tried to publish papers. And since we did not connect with the product teams, all we had was toy data. And we, you know, used some small data sets, toy data sets, worked on things. So these were great ideas, and you know, there were a lot of people putting in effort. Four of us spending a lot of our energies on this problem. We had good solutions. We did all this stuff. But you know, we did not go back and even talk to the product team. This was very unfortunate. And after a while, after a few months into this effort, we did have a hearing from the senior folks and also the product team, somebody from the product team. And at that time when we made the case, they were, you know, well, they thought, okay, it's promising, but we could not give any guarantees on the quality of the integrated, the denoised, unreliable user-generated data. We could not guarantee that, okay, you were going to get 90% precision or this level of recall, because we had not even, you know, got round to mucking with the data. We had not grabbed the data. And so essentially, since we could not convince them with hard data and metrics, you know, at least on a reasonable toy data set, we basically lost this opportunity to influence a big, like a very important direction that Yahoo could have taken. And so because of this, then the, and since we had already wasted our, you know, the leeway that we had in terms of doing research, it was almost a year into the effort and we didn't have anything tangible to show. So we were pushed into, you know, doing more information extraction from reliable sources. So it took almost 2-3 years before we could get back to that problem and do something. And we had essentially lost that opportunity. So the thing I take away from this is, you know, we were like, most of us were young, they were not, it's really important to have these channels and good, well thought out processes of how to take ideas and put it back into product. And it's also important that, you know, young researchers who come straight out of universities are, you know, sort of guided in this process, and, you know, they need to really understand that it is not like, especially in research teams, they need to understand that it's not just about publication. And just because you have something working, it doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, you have an idea and you have an algorithm, doesn't mean it will immediately become a product. People will not take things that's working unless they have, you know, some kind of ulterior motive or some strong motive from their point of view, whether it is, you know, improving the performance of their products, or, you know, whether, unless it meets their needs, it's very tough to do it. And it also helps to find a good champion. So you need to convince the right people, and it's not just the ideas, the who passes the idea around, how it is passed around, how it is presented, actually matter way more. And that's something I learned, you know, much later on, after all this thing.
I think I also can relate to this idea of having a champion of your, you know, your idea and your baby, and that pushing, taking that idea, believing in you and taking that idea all the way. Anybody else wants to share an experience?
Sure, I can talk about. The example I'm going to give is more about how when you sort of build a product, everybody judges the final product and not, let's say, the data innovation or like the other research innovation that you've done. So we actually had this happen with our project where we knew we wanted to understand, let's say, what a user does on Google. And let's say, you know, you are traveling to Kerala. Let's say that's what you've done on Google. Now, knowing that that's what you're doing, you can build, let's say, a better search experience. You can do many things. So we started off with, okay, first we built that data, and then we built an experience around it. And then we started showing it to people. And what happened is that everybody started looking at that end result and saying, oh, this is too radical. Oh, this, you know, they formed opinions on that. And in our view, we had this amazing data source, and nobody was, you know, sort of looking at that. And then what we did was we actually stepped back and said, okay, let's just sort of just show people the data. They can look at their own data and get convinced. Because when you show somebody and say, okay, you know what, why don't you just go to this interface and look at your own data, and they just have that wow feeling when they look at, oh, this is what I've done. There's nothing better to convince someone. You can show as many examples as you want, but working on your own data, which they have not trained on, or anything, is just works really well. And what happened to us, so I would say that, you know, the first stage of where we built our incarnation of the product, it was a failure. But then when we just showed the data, then people got convinced, and then they started coming to us and they said, oh, you know, like, we want to build this product around it. And we actually integrated with Android, with Google Plus, and we're doing it with Search. So there's everything then just happens. So I would say that you do any product, failure is always going to be part of it. You cannot expect things to work the first time. It's not, I would say, it's very rare that happens. I mean, if it happens, great, you know, like, you get a launch immediately. But what's more likely is, you know, this constant iteration period and incorporate feedback.
Very interesting. Moving on. So, Aarti, I think I want to direct that question to you. We've often heard that large companies are unable to innovate anymore. We have counterexamples of both Google and Amazon are large enough, you know, product companies. And, you know, why do you think that myth is there? And
I think large companies get associated with a lot of process and bureaucracy, etc. And that's why people feel that it's going to be hard to, you know, come up with new ideas and get them accepted. But I mean, I don't believe so. I mean, at Amazon, I see innovation every day. And I think the reason it works is, first of all, the culture and the values of the company support innovation in a very strong way. One really has to innovate every day, really, to perform well in your role. And also, even though Amazon as a whole is a very large company, you know, we get set up into certain verticals or certain business teams. And there's a concept of two pizza teams, in fact, at Amazon, which is the size of a team which can eat two pizzas, which can be fed on two pizzas. And so these two pizza teams are teams that are set up to innovate on new ideas or new products. So really, what I'm saying is, if the culture of the company supports innovation, then I think the size doesn't matter. And I mean, I've seen it in practice in both the companies, in fact, that I've worked in.
Yeah, what I'll say is that what I've seen of people, you get, when you're at a larger company, you get really caught up with the day-to-day work. Like, you have to maintain the site, you have to maintain the product. Like, let's say, you know, for search, spam is a huge problem. If you leave things as is, things are going to deteriorate very quickly. So you need to keep innovating. And so I would say, you know, a lot of people, everybody wants to work on interesting problems, but given that the site has to be up, and that there are interesting problems within those parameters, that you just get caught up in the everyday things. So I would say that you need to push yourself a lot if you actually want to make big strides and or make big changes. It doesn't just happen as part of the organization. And we've also had a lot of these competitions or something to kind of, okay, everybody just go off for a week and think about it. And I haven't seen too many successes with that. I mean, things do come up with it, come out that way. But the way I've seen these things happen is somebody just says, okay, you know what, I want to build this. And they just go off on their own. It's unstructured. Nobody says, oh, spend this 1 week doing it. They just do it in their free time. And they build something, and then it has that wow factor, and then you go and build something. And so it's not that innovation is dead. It's more that I think you have to sort of encourage people or, you know, if somebody tells you that, oh, I have this idea, like, you need to sort of encourage that a bit, and then things will move forward.
I have something to add here. I just really just now sense that IBM is a much bigger organization, you know, in terms of numbers, in terms of, you know, I don't know, not probably the valuation, but definitely in terms of the number of people, the groups, and how distributed it is relative to most other big companies that we talk about, like Amazon, Yahoo, Facebook, Google, and so on. So one thing I do want to share about IBM, because this was something very interesting to me once I learned this myself, is that, you know, it's a huge company. It's a 100 plus years company, the pretty old tech company, and they have survived all these days. And, you know, the trick to their survival is just that they have adapted to their needs. And a big part of it is their, like, really well thought out innovation process. It's tough. It's not a myth that you cannot do innovation in large orgs of the scale of IBM. It can be done. It's just that, you know, it is tough and it takes a lot of effort. So just keep in mind that, you know, unlike the other companies we're talking about, IBM, you know, does a variety of things. They manage customer care services, some mortgage processes. They are into nano computing, weather modeling, name it, and you'll, you know, find IBM's hand somewhere. And the other thing about IBM is the way they are structured, the research organization is actually a completely different division from the, it's like, you know, even compared to Yahoo, I was talking about a disconnect there, but this is a different organization with no direct channels of communication to the rest of the organization. Right? So given that this is an organization that's so big, they really had to think through how to do this, and the way they went about it is like through, I would like probably broadly categorize it as like three steps. One is to figure out which are the areas to innovate on as a company, and I'll get into that more a little bit. And the other one is to find mechanisms to connect people from research, business, engineering teams. And the last thing is like a very rigorous funding process, which is very capitalistic and not necessarily very fast moving, but it finally works. So maybe I can tell a little bit about the first one if I have time. There's this thing called Global Technology Outlook, and which was fairly interesting to me because I didn't know about it before going to IBM. And this is not something that's internal to IBM. They share it with you know, academia, they share it with their clients, partners, governments, and so on. So what this is a comprehensive analysis of you know, disruptive technologies, you know, interesting technologies that could change IBM and the world, and they kind of look ahead, say maybe 3 to 10 years or a little more than that. And it's a very nice bottom-up process, a multi-stage bottom-up process distributed across the you know, world, across the company. And you know, it's a process of gathering data, gathering ideas, reviewing them, evaluating, filtering the things that, you know, are not necessarily that important, merging ideas. And at the end of the year, and it's a year-long process, right? So at the end of the year, they identify some 5-6 big themes. And these kind of help in figuring out areas of investment. And because they have these areas of investment, right, it sort of sets the agenda for the research team, the business engineering teams to focus on. So this I thought was something nice and something that a big organization has to do just to, you know, be in the play and, you know, not lose out on in terms of innovation.
Interesting, yeah. You said innovation process, right? So I think two words which are couldn't be at more contrast with each other, but I guess they figured it out, right?
Yeah, I mean, they had to do it, I guess. See, they're the ones who are doing quantum computing, brain simulations. No other company is doing it because, you know, they have that extra bandwidth. They figured, you know, it's useful.
I'll just add one more point to what Surbhi said about sort of, you know, in a big company, you have to keep your business running, right? We use the phrase keeping the lights on. What I do believe, though, is that even in those processes, there are a lot of opportunities for innovation. You know, sometimes we sort of, you know, we put research on a pedestal or new product development, especially if we have dedicated teams. You know, we sometimes tend to compartmentalize and say those are the teams that are going to do innovation. But it really isn't true. I think in some of these day-to-day processes also, there's a lot of innovation needed, let's say, for reducing manual interventions, making things a lot more automated, making things more efficient. And I think even those, you know, some of those small things can lead to sort of big efficiencies in the organization. And so we should not discount those, was the point I was trying to make.
Actually, Aarti, you actually wear a management hat as well, right? So can you talk about, you know, putting a timeline on an ROI kind of value to research, right? When is it enough already, right? So can you?
Yeah, so that is difficult in some ways, especially when you're building a new product, because you have nothing to go by. You don't really know if you're going to reach the goal or the ROI that you're setting up for yourself. Now, having said that, you know, in the product development world, at least, I mean, we are not a pure research team. And so we do have constraints where typically if we take up a new project or product, in a 6 months to 1 year timeline, we have to show some initial either feasibility, call it ROI, call it a prototype. You know, I think some, you have to be able to prove to, you know, the business that you're able to build something viable. And so that sort of, you know, if you're starting from scratch, I would say that, you know, typically a year, and I'm saying that because, like, when we started this team last year, and we started these new projects, that was sort of the typical timeline we were given, that, you know, by end of next year, or actually within 9 months, that we should build out and show the system to be working, show some initial results. And then, of course, you can iterate and build more. So it's not that you have to get a large value right up front, but you have to be able to show at least a viability of the product within this type of a timeline. And one of the approaches we've used is to start with simple things. So when you're building a new system, start with implementing the simplest ideas, but make sure that your design incorporates things such that the more layered and more complex ideas that you have can be built into it later. So you don't box yourself in so that your product always stays simple, but you implement only the simple things first, with knowing that, you know, you're building in hooks that you can add in more things to the product at a later stage.
It's a great perspective. Any other thoughts?
Oh, you
want to
go? I think my point, what I want to say in this is just that deadlines help because it's easy to get lost in the details. And especially when you're really passionate about your own idea, you're like, no, I can just do this little thing and it'll work. And it's like, no, I'll just spend 1 week more. And like, we all know that like that 1 week isn't really 1 week because something happens, things always take longer than you think. And so, it is an art actually to be able to say for your own project that no, you know what, this is not going anywhere, we're going to try this other thing. That itself is, not many people can do that, but so I feel like deadlines or having these timelines, and you can set them yourself, it doesn't even need to be an external or somebody else telling you, but if you say, okay, in 3 months I think I should achieve this, and if I don't, then okay, this is going to be my next plan. So I just think that it helps in especially a product org where people do want to see some tangible results.
So I just wanted to, I guess, those are great responses. So I don't have a lot to add, but the one thing that I feel is like deadlines are really important. It's important to know that you're making progress because there's, especially for research teams, there's a big danger of getting lost. And it's not just getting lost in the nitty-gritty details. Sometimes you lose, sight of what you really want to achieve, that you want to build this, that like enhances somebody's customer experience. We lose track of that when we, get deep into things, or, we take a new branch and keep following it. So I think it's important to have these timelines, but the way you set the timelines really depends on the nature of work. See, right now we are talking mostly about computer science research, but if you go to some other domain like molecular biology or maybe go to chemistry or physics, research is of a totally different nature. You cannot really guarantee or expect things to happen on time or in the time frame of a year or say even a couple of years. And what I have seen in my experience is that, it really varies. It depends on the nature of work, and we need to set timelines, maybe a 6 month or quarterly goal, so that we know we are on the right track and we are not getting lost. Or, it's important to fail fast. If you are anyway going to fail, or it's not going to work for whatever reason, or the box you're operating in changes entirely, you would like to know that sooner than later. So deadline, these having some timeline is important, but the ROI is a difficult thing for research. It depends on the nature of work. That's why, you know, most research teams are evaluated based on their...
I think there the ROI question comes very important.
Yeah.
I would just add that it's a hard call, right? Hard if the 10% is really worth a lot of dollar value and, you know, you can pay good researchers for 3 years to do that stuff, then they would definitely...
And making long-term bets is important. So, you know, while we are talking about deadlines and more short-term goals that within, you know, a year, 6 months, a year, you have to show something. If you, you know, whatever it is that you're building, if the organization believes that that's something that's going to add value to them, making sure that the organization stays with it for the longer term. So, you know, you may have tried and you got a prototype, but maybe you're not getting the ROI that you had initially targeted. But if the potential is there, you can see that, okay, by doing X, Y, and Z more things, we may be able to turn this product around. So having the organizations buy in to make it a long-term bet, of course, it doesn't always happen. Mm-hmm. But what I'm saying is when you can get that support, then you get the combination of both. So you're still pushing yourself to deadlines to make sure that you're, you know, moving ahead. But at the same time, you have the backing to know that, you know, this is a long-term bet that your team is working on.
Great. I think we're running out of time. I would love to hear from the audience. Any one of you in a research role and have worked on some interesting projects, successful, unsuccessful? We've got a couple of hands, one over there and one here, please. Yeah, go ahead. Okay, you can be loud. I think I can hear you.
I actually have a question. It's posed to all three panelists. What do you think are the top three success factors in converting a research project into an actual successful product?
In front of you, wants to try it?
Yeah, so for me, I really think, okay, this is the way I have maybe like a 5 or 6 step process that I've learned over the years. So one thing I figure out is that a research idea might be cute and good, but it's really important to rigorously and critically evaluate it for yourself to make sure that there is a strong business case. So maybe you could do something good, but if there is a simpler way to achieve the same thing, or, you know, get to 90% of what you want doing 10% of the effort, then, you know, you don't have a strong business case. So one needs to really rigorously evaluate the ideas. The other thing I feel is like to put yourself in a position, you know, move yourself within the organization, or, you know, move across organizations, or even start your own organization. Like, go to a place where you are empowered to do this, to explore your new ideas, to, like, you know, bring it to fruition. So that's, I think, important, being in the right place. Then the other thing I find is that you really need mentors, and wherever you are, it's important to figure out the process. Once you know the end goals, I mean, you know, this is where you are and this is where you want to get to. And the process is different from one organization to another. So it's really important to figure that process out and then execute it. And in my case, what I figured out is, you know, most of the places I have been, since it's like primarily research groups, it's really important to understand the language of the product teams, build bridges, not be condescending. They're doing great stuff. They know a lot about things we don't know. So I need to learn that part of it. So that was important. And take baby steps, like Aarti said, right? Whatever great ideas you have, it won't be very meaningful to them unless you are like delivering things that are tangible, that make a difference to them. And you need to like really go take small steps, celebrate the small victories, learn from the mistakes, and, you know, prepare for the next round. So that is what has, you know, really worked the few times that, you know, we've managed to send something all the way from, you know, some abstract idea to a real thing on some web portal. So that's that's all I have. But yeah, it's a nice question.
Hi, I'm Chavi. I work for the research group in NetApp. I'm personally exploring data object storage space, and since we are almost out of time, I had a question for you folks. There was a talk of, you know, getting buy-in from your stakeholders and developing channels with the product teams. So I would like to hear from you, as in, how do you go about it? How do you get that buy-in? and how do you build channels where none exist?
Okay, let me summarize your question. You're asking how do you open the channels to product teams coming from a pure research org to take your idea to product? Is that what you asked?
Yes, and so that's one part of it. And even when you're proposing ambitious ideas or ambitious projects, how do you even get the buy-in to begin with? So
how do you get the buy-in?
The beginning and the end, these two questions.
I think I answered you. Anyone wants to take
that? I would say, There are sort of channels within your organization or your product area. So one is that, you know, you keep going up the chain, up your chain, go to your manager, go to your manager's manager. The other thing I have to say is, if you send somebody an email and say, I want 15 minutes of your time, the worst that's going to happen is they don't reply. So if you want to just, like, let's say I work in search and I want to do something in mobile, and I feel like, you know, this person, I think if I just can show them this demo, then things will just work. Then that's just a way of cold calling and saying, you know, hey, I have this idea, and like maybe even if you build a prototype, just send a link, right? And you can send that off as an email. So I would say there are, you know, sort of set ways doing it in your organization. You can do it this other way. I'll let the other people chime in.
Yeah, I think these were points brought up earlier, but you know, when you show your idea, making your results very tangible, like she spoke about, you know, showing it on their data. So when they can connect to whatever it is you're saying, so rather than talking about your idea in the abstract, actually showing the value on the things that person can connect with can help, convince much more easily. So that's something I've seen, that, you know, you can come up with great ideas and you can put really fancy slides, but until the stakeholder or the customer can connect with it from their perspective, it's very hard to, for them to appreciate the idea or the value.
So actually, Aarti, this is sort of directed to you, more because you manage a team as well as the point that you brought up. So innovating within your own sort of stream, right? So you already have a product you're maintaining and you need to innovate in that. That doesn't somewhat turn out to be as glamorous as coming up with a like fancy new idea that sort of catches everybody's attention. How do you encourage people to actually do that? I mean, you know, is there something that you do with as an organization where you reward people for that? How do you recognize that? You know, it just doesn't come across as sort of visible as right. Something that's like a brand new idea.
So definitely, I think what I said earlier, the culture and values of the organization, in my experience, go a long way in terms of helping with that. So for example, in Amazon, you know, operational excellence is something that is given a lot of value. So if you come up with ways in which, let's say, you reduce the latency on a page, which, if you think of it as a project, it doesn't sound very exciting at all that you want to reduce your latency from 100 milliseconds to 80 milliseconds. But it makes a huge difference to our customers. And that kind of a project gets very high visibility in, within the teams or within the organization. And so that helps. So then your team members are not thinking, okay, I'm working on something that's more boring than another project. It's like this is the project or one of the, best projects to work on in the company because it gets that high visibility. So that helps a lot. I think the organization supporting that. And then, of course, within your team, you want to make sure that you appreciate those things that are being done. So sometimes these small things get done and managers may not notice or other people may not notice. So really, as a manager, you have to watch out for them and make sure that, you appreciate the person who has come up with that innovation. Make sure that it gets visibility to your senior managers so that then that encourages the culture within the team to look for those types of things.
I'm not a manager, but I do work with a lot of junior colleagues, and I actually take a great pleasure in interacting with them because I'm often very rusty and they know a lot more. And one of the things, I mean, there are multiple things that work, but one of the things that really works well is to build this group where people can speak without any inhibition and set aside some time, maybe weekly, bi-weekly, with not really, of course there will be group meeting with concrete agenda, but half an hour or an hour in once in 2 weeks, just to think big, in sense like, you know, think about the ideas that change the world, or you know, depending on the context, maybe you know, in the for the group, the things that could like really make a big difference. Just sitting around when you don't have the pressure of some deadlines and just thinking about what we could do, you know, just changes the way you do the rest of the things. It's possible that you think about stuff and then don't go and implement them, but it changes the way you look at things. And of course, if something nice comes up, then the other thing I find is to make sure there's a collaborative environment. So a lot of these times, so one other thing I've seen in a lot of places is that there are deadlines and not people don't have enough time in their 20% extra slot or the stretch assignments to really do big things on their own. So being able to foster an environment where multiple youngsters or multiple folks can work together makes each other's 20% a lot more meaningful. So 20% from three people directed towards a project becomes much nicer and more effective than everybody's individual 20%. So that's something I, I found it worked in some cases.
That's great. Any other questions?
Thank you guys. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
thanks to all of you.